Welcome to worship this morning at Bayham Memorial United Methodist Church. I am Pastor Amy Chapman. Greet you on this Ascension Sunday, the seventh Sunday of the Easter season. What a joy it is to be together in the house of the Lord. Would you join me in your voices as we praise God together in our call to worship? In your bulletin, would you respond in the bold print? Praise the Lord, all the people, for our Savior has been raised on high. Jesus Christ, who was crucified and has risen from the dead, now sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. Jesus will come again, bringing the fullness of God's kingdom. Praise be to our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Oh God, we ask that as we gather here, that you would ready our hearts, God, to be with you in this place, in this time of worship, in this hour. God, center our hearts on your word and on your presence here. Holy Spirit, come and dwell among us as we unite our hearts together in worship today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to invite you, if you would, to stand as we join our voices in praise, singing together our opening hymn of praise, number 701, When We All Get to Heaven. Online, we welcome you here now. Ask that you join us in worship. servant's heart, the way that she loves our children. Miss Christina is downstairs with the nursery, and they'll join also for Sunday school this morning. Goodbye. We love you. We'll see you soon.
Just a few announcements at this time. If you've noticed inside your bulletin, today is the fifth Sunday. It's on every month with the fifth Sunday we give, take up for the Kentucky United Methodist Children's Home. If you'd like to give today, please put that offering in the envelope and just put it in the offering plate as it comes around. If you didn't come prepared to give today, that's okay. You can give next week or just whenever you can. Also, just a reminder that we do have our 10 a.m. fellowship gathering. Thanks to Jim, who brings the donuts every Sunday morning, for that downstairs in the fellowship hall. And also our 10:30 a.m. Bible study on Tuesdays, and our Wednesday Bible study at 6:30. And are there any other announcements that need to be brought to our attention? Any joys or prayer concerns? Go ahead, Sally.
It's not good for me, but Alan and I have been together today for 55 years.
Oh, today is yours and Alan's 55th anniversary. Congratulations. Oh, yesterday.
I'm sorry. Yes. But we're still celebrating.
You're one day in then to 50.
I'm glad you said it. I'm glad you mentioned it because I skipped birthdays.
I don't think I was here last time.
Yeah. Our birthday's this week. Our birthdays this week, Steve Whitaker on the 2nd, and also Dave and Paula Peters. Yesterday was your all's anniversary also. 34, I'm sorry. Are there any other birthdays or anniversaries? Any joys or prayer concerns? Any other joys or prayer concerns?
I'd like to have a prayer out for our dear friend and brother, Johnny Clark. He's back on track and he looks great. He looks great in
good.
That's Johnny Sparks. Doing pretty good.
Looking great.
Good. Any unspoken requests? A show of hands. Thank you. Lauren?
My mom has been seeing a lot of that. Our children are on the grandkids, it's all there. Mom's blood pressure is kind of acting a little crazy. Not too concerned. She talked to her daughter, so she's been on pressure back home. She's going to be sick a week, but dad's traveling back home tomorrow. So it's kind of hard to see her because it's Memorial Day.
Thank you. 173. And if you feel led, you may come down to the altar at this time if you'd like to be with the Lord in that way. And you may remain seated for number 173.
Who are in Christ Jesus might live more abundantly. thank you, O God, that your Son sits with you now at your right hand to wait for the day when every knee will bow on heaven and on earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. God, we ask that your glory would shine around us today as we pray for one another and as you pray with us and you pray for us. The prayer that you taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Our first scripture lesson today is a gospel lesson as we revisit John's gospel. I would ask today, in honor of Ascension Sunday and the reading and the hearing of the gospel today, that we would stand together as we hear Jesus' words just before Jesus is led into the garden and prays for us. Hear now the Gospel of John, chapter 17, verses 20 through 26. I ask, Jesus says, not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, that they may be completely one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. This is the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Word of God, for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may be seated.
At this time, as we prepare to give of our tithes and offerings, may we reflect on just how gracious God has been to us.
Thank you.
Father, we just give you so many thanks to be able to give to your kingdom. We know that it comes from you. Just take and multiply these gifts that we give so that you may grow your kingdom. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning again. Thank you, James and Karen, especially. That trumpet really helps fill the void of not having an organ sound today, so we're very grateful for that talent and that gift. I'm grateful we have a small house. The trumpet sounds a lot louder in our house than it does. James has been practicing some of these past couple of days. It's a beautiful, beautiful sound. Welcome this morning to Mayo Church. If you're joining us online, I'd ask that you turn in your Bibles to page Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 13, and here also. If you don't have your Bibles with you, you're welcome to turn in your Pew Bible to page 1152. We are nearing the end of a year-long narrative lectionary text preaching series, all the way from Genesis, when we began in the liturgical year, liturgical calendar year, and now here we are in Philippians. We'll celebrate Pentecost next Sunday as we welcome the Holy Spirit among us again and celebrate the birthday of the church, and then we'll go into the summer season with a couple of different preaching texts. But we finish today the narrative lectionary with Philippians chapter 2 and Paul's words to the Philippians, the church in Philippi, as he shares with them some encouragement, some consolation, as they figure out together what it means for them as a newly formed congregation to be and continue to be the church. Remember, Paul is writing this letter in jail. We heard last week Paul is writing to them. This is one of the very first churches that Paul established while he was in prison and with Silas. And it was a special church to Paul. And he writes to them in that relationship of them being special friends and encouraging them to continue to be the church, even though he's not there with them anymore and can't be, that they can continue together to press on. And Paul writes now to the church in Philippi saying, "If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the very name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Human likeness Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. We know that Christ values a compassionate heart. We see in Matthew's Gospel in chapter 9 that Jesus shows compassion on people. We read in this Gospel lesson in Matthew in the 36th verse, it says, when Jesus saw the crowds, that he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless. They were like sheep without a shepherd. Jesus saw them and his heart felt compassion toward them. We know that Jesus had prayerful dependence on God. Luke reminds us that Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. We know that prayer is a value, a great value. We know that Christ prays for us even now as he sits at the right hand of God the Father. And so we consider today this mind of Christ. How do we get it? How do we have the mind of Christ? Can we hang out with Jesus enough that we start to think like Jesus does? I think we can. I think this can be a practice of sorts that's developed. Because we know the more time that you spend with someone, I'm sure there's sometimes that somebody just gets you and you find you have so much in common that you tend to think a lot. But also, with practicing being with someone, you start to think more like them. You start to think how they think. You start to act like they act. Jesus called this abiding in him, abiding in Christ. Paul writes to the church in Corinth that we can literally take our thoughts and hold them captive. We can make them obedient to Christ. I don't know if you've ever tried this, but that's easier said than done for me. I am easily distracted, and there are things sometimes within our mental health and within our own minds that can cause us to not be able to take control of our own minds. Hear that. That's a real thing. Mental health is so important. The struggle of the mind, the battle of the mind, is a very real thing. It's a very real thing. How do we do this even in struggling with what's going on in our minds, with putting aside any thoughts that might harm us or harm others? And we center those thoughts somehow around Christ. Certainly, we do that together in community with one another. We do that in prayer, just as God the Father was in unity with the Son and the Spirit. We know that we can be one with each other somehow because Christ prays for that. Christ asks for that we might be one, just as the Holy Trinity is one. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit, just as they are one, that we might be one like that. That's mind-blowing for me. So we look today, what does it mean then to humble ourselves? To understand that we are finite creatures, that we battle things in our mind, we battle things in our body. What does it mean for us to have the mind of Christ? And we see in Philippians that it comes a lot out of humility, that it comes from putting others first just as Christ did. And that's a hard thing. We automatically think of ourselves first, let's be honest, don't we? I mean, when I wake up in the morning, I think, what do I need to get through this day? I think of myself usually first, I'll admit that. Paul says Jesus didn't do that. Jesus thought of others first. So what does that mean, to put others first? To put the safety of our children first? To give up some of our own rights and privileges, to empty ourselves of long-held self-righteous attitudes. I think of the story of a gentleman named Desmond T. Doss. Desmond Doss's story is featured in a movie that was released back in 2016 called Hacksaw Ridge. Unless you have a strong stomach, you might not want to watch it, but the story is extremely powerful, and it's a true story of this man's life. Desmond T. Doss, PFC Desmond T. Doss, who won the Kurgan religious grounds. He was a Seventh-day Adventist religion, and he felt he had a place to serve in the army, but he wanted to be a medic. He didn't want to fight in the war, but he wanted to serve. He believed in the cause of what was happening in World War II, and he wanted to give himself to that cause, but he didn't want to fight. And so he trained without bearing arms. And this movie, Hacksaw Ridge, and this story here tells his story about how he managed to do that. He was criticized. He was harassed in the military as he was training. Honestly, they wanted nothing to do with him. They even tried to have him court-martialed and thrown out of the army, and he would pray. It's really a modern-day Daniel kind of story. He would just pray. Doss's commanding officer, Captain Jack Glover, tried to get him transferred. In a documentary on Doss's life, Glover says that Doss told him, "Don't ever doubt my courage, because I will be right by your side, saving life while you take life." And in Okinawa, in the spring of 1945, Doss's company faced a grueling attack, climbing a steep, jagged cliff that was called Hacksaw Ridge. They climbed to a plateau where thousands of heavily armed Japanese soldiers were there waiting for them. It was a treacherous terrain, and they were under gunfire and explosions. And Doss, the medic who was traveling with his platoon, crawled on the ground from wounded soldier to wounded soldier, unarmed. And he dragged severely injured men to the edge of the ridge, tied a rope around their bodies, lowered them down to the other medics below. In the documentary, Doss says, "I was praying the whole time. I just kept praying." And this is powerful, this prayer. He said, "I just kept praying, Lord, please, help me get one more. Help me get one more." Veteran Carl Bentley, who was also there at Hacksaw Ridge, once said, "It's as if God had his hand on Doss's shoulder. On Doss's shoulder. It's the only explanation I can give." PFC Desmond T. Doss saved 75 men at Hacksaw Ridge, including his captain, Jack Glover, over a 12-hour period. The same soldiers who had shamed him now praised him and said he was one of the bravest persons alive. Glover says in this documentary, "And then to have him end up saving my life was the irony of the whole thing." The irony of the whole thing. I thought of John the Baptist as we look to his example of humility today. John said to the disciples who were following him, he said, "Jesus must become greater. I must become less. Jesus must increase. I must decrease." That's how we humble ourselves in the sight of the Lord. And that's when, friends, we are truly lifted up. We look today to this cause of unity that Paul writes about to the Philippians. We look at separation and division that is certainly all around us and has been and will be. But Jesus' earnest prayer is that we are to be united. Now, Jesus doesn't say in his prayer, we talked about this, "I know there's perfectly good reasons for there being divisions and fractions among you. That's just human nature." Rather, Jesus prays that all of his followers should be one. He makes no distinction between deeply faithful followers or the more casual followers. He says all of them, that all of them might be one. As we listen in on Jesus' prayer that we heard in John's Gospel, we hear Jesus beseeching God on our behalf for all of us, not just those who are in the hearing, but Jesus says, "And all who will believe because of the word that's going to be handed down from generation to generation." For all who will believe, Jesus prays. And in listening in on Jesus' prayer, we hear that desperate cry that he has for unity, for oneness. Why? To be a witness to the world that God so loved, that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him would not perish but have eternal life. Jesus prays. oneness. If you've ever been part of a family or a member of a church or any relationship for that matter, you know that within the bonds of love, there can be a lot of disagreement. There can be a lot of contention. In fact, some of our most serious arguments can be signs that we indeed do deeply love one another. That is not what I'm talking about when I say unity, and I believe it's what Jesus was talking about when he prays for unity. If we didn't care about one another, we wouldn't take the trouble, we wouldn't go through the trouble of fighting it out, right? Of staying to fight. Perhaps in his prayer that all of his followers might be one, Jesus is giving us instruction in how to fight with one another in the church. We can have strong disagreements when our dissension is framed by our strong determination to obey Jesus and to love one another. There is room for that. There certainly is room for that within the church. But there is still unity. There is still love. Because God loves us. He prays. I pray that they will be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. I pray that they also will be one in us, so that the world will believe that Jesus is Lord, that you have sent me. I believe the heart of unity for Jesus is, let me say one more. Beloved, surely that is the mind of Christ. May it be so today, in the name of our beloved Christ. Amen. On this Ascension Sunday, we are called to stand and to affirm our faith as we put our full trust in God, resurrected as Lord, risen today as we remember this Ascension Sunday that Christ rose again and that he will come in glory. Would you stand together as we turn now to the Apostles' Creed, found on page 881, as we affirm our faith together, putting our belief as a sign of unity. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, in the fellowship and unity.